right. Well, as you see by the title, it's called Done to Death, and it's some techniques for finding death, cemetery, probate records. And because especially I'm going to concentrate a lot on if there are is no death certificate, because that makes it harder, but it's not impossible. So here we go, preamble, finding the death certificate, how to find and obtain a certificate. First thing you should do is check family papers. People often keep them, and a lot of people find them when like their parents died or their grandparents died, and they see all this stuff. I mean, you'd be surprised what you can find. My grandmother saved a copy of my grandfather's court martial. Nothing serious. They didn't shoot him or anything. Supposedly, he told a superior officer to get the F out of my kitchen or I will throw you out, or words to that effect. But just to give you an idea, some things you can possibly find. Right. Well, the most important thing is the researcher state, because death records are the province of the states to administer the way they see fit. So it's not like the federal government where it's uniform all across the board. And every state has different points of access. Like, for instance, this is West Virginia, and they actually have instructions. And it said, who may obtain death records less than 50 years old? So in that state, if it's more than 50 years old, it's generally available to the public. If it's less than 50 years old, basically, in pretty much every instance, you're going to need to be someone who has a material interest in obtaining the certificate. And that, of course, would be a spouse, a sibling, a child, a very close relative. Some states allow, like, first cousins, generally not. And usually it's for an executor or a lawyer to help settle an estate. So they all have websites now. So definitely check them out and see what they require. Now, this is Colorado, and a lot of states allow you to order online. Now, the thing is, as you see down here, it says Vital Check. That is a preferred vendor that many states are using now to order, birth, death, all sorts of records. However, they do tend to be a little pricey, but they are the quickest way to get one if you really need one. And if you can avoid that, and some states allow you to do that, you can actually order directly from the state, and it'll take like maybe 10 business days. It will take longer, but generally it's a lot less costly. Another place you might be able to find a death certificate is in a county records. A lot of them keep it. At Lake County actually has a number of old birth, death certificates. Unfortunately, they cannot do that anymore, but at one time they were able to do it, so you will find some. And if you go to lakeclerk.org, I'll say it again so you find it if you're writing notes. It's lakeclerk, all one word, dot O-R-G. And you can search by name, you can choose what kind of certificate you want. The records go back to even before we became a county. They go back to 1884, and we became an official county in 1887. So they do have quite a bit, and they digitized pretty much all of it. It's really cool. But when you go on to the website, just read it very carefully, and it'll explain to you who can get it, how much it costs, how to get it, when you'll get it, all everything you need to know. Now, here's the old school way to do it before there were sites. And we actually have this book upstairs. It's called the International Vital Records Handbook. Comes out about every 5 years. And one of the things you can do, they like the websites, they explain all the current rules for access, the fees, everything you need to know. But they also have the forms, and you could actually copy the form. fill it out, mail it in, do it totally old school. And so if you went upstairs and say, I want to see the vital records handbook, the staff will just show you exactly where it is. And this is how it was done, you know, before the websites. Now, another way to sort of navigate through death records is go through magazines, genealogy magazines. And actually, one of the things you should ask upstairs is that the library has this excellent database, a magazine database called Flipster. And if I remember correctly, Family Tree magazine is one of the ones that you can read it. So you don't have to get a subscription, but they can be very informative. This one is called Finding Genealogy Details and Death Certificates, because sometimes there are things there that maybe you might not have noticed, and they're sort of explaining to you, this is what you should look for. And sometimes you run into these very unusual deaths. This is my uncle, Frank, and he was run over by a car in the early 70s. And he was a cook, so he died in Cumberland County, but he actually lived in another county. And you know what, most and it's one of the things they show you, most modern death certificates, they show you who the funeral director was, where the interment is. So if it's a relative that you didn't know personally, but you, let's say you happen to be going down that way and you wanted to visit the grave, that'll tell you, you know, where they actually are. And of course, the most important thing, gives you time of death. Now, what was unusual, I don't think they would do this today, but they didn't consider it to be, most accidents today, usually they'll ask you if you want an autopsy. In this case, they didn't. But we'll get to that a little later about autopsies, because you can, in certain limited circumstances, get records for an autopsy if there was one done. Now, one of the other places you'll find is county records. Now, there's a little crossover here, because once again, every state does something different. And this is from West Virginia. And this person here, it's Wilcox with a little line. You see it right in the middle, Wilcox, and they have a line through it. That would have been an older sibling of my father. And he was born in McDowell County, West Virginia, but he did not survive. And, you know, you could always say, well, you know, how do I know it's the right person? Because this, my father never, ever mentioned any of his older siblings who died. My grandparents had 10 children and 6 of them lived to adulthood. And, this was copied by the state of West Virginia and digitized and put on their website. So it's no longer in the province exclusively of the county. But I knew it was the right Wilcox, because on the second page of the ledger, it shows you the parents' names and their state of origin. And that completely checked out. And especially for my grandmother, because her name was unusual. Her name was Rosa Ellen. And that's not something you generally run into. But this is the other thing you got to remember. Sometimes this stuff is still in the county. And many, many times these things are not indexed. This record is from 1903. And, you know, sometimes they know where it is. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes they just let you loose in the room and you just got to look through everything you think. But you just have to, I think the most important thing is you have to know where the records are, who's got the record. And wow, no death certificate. I borrowed this from the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And it says, don't panic, in large friendly letters on the cover, as they said. And there are ways of finding a death when there is no death certificate, because every state started requiring this at different times, and every state is different. Now, Florida is a good example of this, because we didn't start universal death certificate registration or vital statistics until 1917. And of course, it took a couple of years to get compliance, especially in the middle of the pandemic, the 1918 Spanish flu, because there was a huge shortage of doctors and nurses. Most people were cared for by their families. They died at home and they were buried. So there was no death certificate. A lot of doctors that they were, they say, well, I don't know why I have to do this. And they wouldn't send a record to Tallahassee. And so sometimes there are these big, big gaps. Now, this is one of the ways you can actually sort of track down a death. Just find the same person in different U.S. census records. And even though it's 10 years, and for instance, my grandfather was in the 1910 census, but he wasn't in the 1920 census. So already, if I knew nothing else, I've got it limited sometime between April of 1910 and April of 1920, he died. And another thing that can help you, this is actually for a while between 1850 and 1880, the U.S. Census had these special enumeration schedules. They were called mortality schedules. And anyone who had died that year or the year previous would be there. And one of the things they have, see on the balloon on the right, cause of death. I actually helped someone. They found out that their ancestor had died in Michigan of typhoid, which is very common then. And that was the death record. You should also check if there are any family Bibles, because I would actually ask all of my relatives, because somebody, if there was one in your family, somebody has it. And they might be willing to let you come and look at it and record the information, because some of these Bibles, they have like 100 years of births and deaths. So that's one thing you should definitely look at. Now, there's other ways if no one in your family has it. For a long time now, a lot of state libraries and the Library of Congress have actually received donations of family Bibles, because you know, people find them in yard sales and jumbo sale. They don't know who owns them, but they feel that they shouldn't be thrown out. You know, it's not their family, but it's somebody's family. And so they say, well, let me donate it to a library and maybe somebody will find it. So that's definitely something you should investigate. And we'll go a little bit more to a related thing in a minute. Now, religious records, before people started doing it for the state, if they were good churchgoers, they, of course, would be buried in the churchyard. And of course, there would be a funeral. And so there would be something to indicate when they died. And you'd be surprised. Sometimes these indexes are put on the web, but more often they're not. More often than not, you would look in the home county, wherever your ancestor lived, and see if you can write to all the churches. Now, of course, it's best if you know their denomination. But if you don't, you should write to all of them anyway, because sometimes they change, and we'll go into that a little later. Sometimes people change their religion. They go to a different church. They marry someone and convert to another denomination. There's all things. And it happens to a lot of families, because I have an ancestor who married Sarah Boone, Daniel's older sister, and she was a Quaker and William Wilcoxon was not. And their father, her father, Squire Boone, was actually cast out. They call it reading out of the meeting in Pennsylvania, because not only did he allow her to marry out, but her brother Israel also married out. So they, perfect case, they were Quakers who probably were became Episcopalians. And that happened to a lot of people. So that's something worth looking for. Another thing is, and this, if you're looking on the county records and also religious records, don't just look in one county, because county boundaries change. You might be looking in the wrong county and the wrong church in the wrong county. So definitely look at that, because it can get very complex. My father's grandmother was not the same Protestant denomination he was. So these things do change. Now, of course, newspapers, and this is getting easier and easier all the time, because there are all sorts of databases and that you can use. Now, they have paid databases like Genealogy Bank and newspapers.com, but there is a free one. Your federal taxes pay for it. It's from the Library of Congress, and I wrote it up there. It's chroniclingamerica.loc.gov. And even if you just Google Chronicling America, it'll come right up. And they have newspapers, digitized newspapers for the whole country from the mid 18th century to the mid 20th. So you have a good shot at finding something. Okay, everybody got that down? Okay. And now one of the things is that there's two ways a death was recorded. There's a death certificate, but there's also a death notice that was often put in a paper. And in this case, this is my grandfather. I was named for him, Thomas Q. Wilcox. And they don't agree as to the cause of death. The death notice says that he suffered an illness of 2 weeks with rheumatism. But if you look at the top, that's the death notice. It says infective endocarditis. So that's what the physician said he died of. But beneath that, a contributing cause was rheumatism. So rheumatism was still on the table. And he worked, in fact, the mine he worked for still exists. It's the Pocahontas mine. It straddles Mercer and McDowell counties in West Virginia. And it's still an operating coal mine, and it's very hot and wet working down the mine. So I'm sure rheumatism was a big problem. And he was not that old. He was about 53 when he died. Now, you should also look in local history collections, and this is from our project collection, and these were originally cards that we actually had printed information. And what it was is that they would have a person's name. This person was J.C. Looming. He was the state treasurer. He says he died in 1928. And this is from a Leesburg commercial newspaper from March 5th, 1937. So you definitely found a death date. It definitely was in the period when Florida was issuing death certificates. So you could get that. But the library is digitizing them, and check out the library website. They actually have a tab for Leesburg Library Digital Collections, and you'll find it there. And a lot of places have things like that. We also upstairs have a genealogy-oriented obituary collection, and it's going back, I guess, 1980s. Yeah, and it goes back decades. And, you know, we get them, we cut them out of the papers, do really old school. We put them on the cards. And so you should definitely, if it's a local death, you can definitely go upstairs and check them. It's still in a card catalog. Eventually they will be digitized, but there's a lot of issues involved in doing that. And I don't work here anymore, so I'm not really privy to all. Yeah. But now there's also other places to help. And a lot of people don't know about this, but FamilySearch.org, which is the Mormon Church website, that's FamilySearch.org. They have these things called wikis, and they are excellent sources for finding out if you do like North Carolina genealogy wiki. They actually have this full dedicated page explaining every single record they possibly can get and how to find it. And it's an excellent guide, and they do it for every state, every county, every city. I mean, it's really a marvel to behold. And it really, if you want to know quickly how to get any sort of record in a particular place, this is the place to go to. Another thing is, don't forget to use their catalog. There's a lot of things that they haven't digitized yet, but they have. And one of the things you can do is arrange to go to one of their family history centers. And if there's something that has to come from Salt Lake, they can arrange that, and you have to view it there. But they have copy machines, they have microfilm machines, they have, you know, everything that you could possibly want, but they have a lot of different stuff. And one of the things is death records of Lumpkin County, Georgia. And they have it from 1936 to 1945. And there's, you know, excellent things. But it's, if it's not digitized, you can still get access to it. So you just have to go, most cases, you have to go to them. Sometimes there are some things that we are what they call a family history library, and they do allow some things, but they've been working very hard putting these things on digital records, because one of the main reasons is that they stopped making microfilm film in this country. And so it's no longer possible for them to microfilm everything. So now they're just going directly to digital, and their avowed aim is that everything they have is going to be digital. So before you ask the Family History Center to get something for you, just check your home computer, go onto their, you know, catalog. You'll see it at FamilySearch.org, and you can find out whether it's digital or not. And I'll show you how. You see what they've got? That little camera right in the middle? That it means there's a digital image that you can get from your computer. And what the thing is, though, is that sometimes you'll see a little padlock on it. And this is, and when you see that, that means you have to go to a Mormon Family History Center or to an affiliate library like Leesburg. And, you know, the computers, they have, it's like VIN numbers on a car. Every computer has its own ID number, and they'll know it's coming from an approved, you know, computer. Yours is not, but the library's is. And so they'll be glad to. And if you can come in, as long as you give something specific and they have the time, they can generally do it. Because you, once you get the record up, you can print it, you can download it, you can attach it. Yeah, I mean, it's very, very versatile. But this is an excellent, excellent website. Now, this is interesting about obit clues. This is a very old obituary for my Revolutionary War's like fourth great grandfather. His name is Daniel Howell, and he died in Virginia. And it gives you a lot of the, I mean, it actually mentions twice that he was a soldier of the revolution. In fact, the headline says, another revolutionary soldier gone, because he was part of the greatest generation of the 19th century. And so that was considered to be news, but there's all these clues. Like it said that he died on the 5th of March. This was 1836. He was 77 years old. He was in a feeble state, which, I mean, 77. I mean, most people didn't make it past 40 in those days. So he had an astonishingly long life. George Washington himself died at 67. And that was considered to be a pretty good age. And it says he was, Mr. Howe was a soldier of the revolution and died. They even have a quote, full of years and full of honor. And he says he left a wife with several children and friends. So he apparently was generally well-liked. And at the bottom, see that little pointing figure? They're asking the Lynchburg Democrat and Richmond Inquirer are requested to copy. If you see that, it means he was known in those two cities. He died near Danville, but apparently he had dealings in Lynchburg and in Richmond because he was a farmer, and he actually deeded his land to his sons, and he had $150 a year as a Revolutionary War pensioner, which was a good sum in those days. And but they tell you now, I went on to Chronicling America, and they don't have the Lynchburg Democrat. However, the Richmond Inquirer, they do have, and I was searching to see if they might have printed it. Maybe they had a detail about what he was doing in that city, but they didn't print it because I used to work on my school paper, and it's, you have to make a lot of choices, what goes in, what goes out, because you can't do a 5-page newspaper. It's got to be 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, whatever. And you should also look, newspapers also have accounts of accidents. This happened to a young man who actually fell into the hold of a steamship called the City of Paris. It was in the 1880s and 1889, you know, just before Christmas, very depressing. And I actually went on to Google Maps to see where his address was, and it's currently occupying the same spot as the West Side Highway. So it's, there's no house there anymore, but sometimes you can have a little fun playing around if you have an actual address. Now, one thing about newspapers is that death notices, they often can give you some very, very valuable information about the relative health of the deceased. And if you get a whole bunch of them, you really can find out a lot. And it sort of fills out the story. Now, this was Thomas Luther Wilcox, and he was the first Thomas. I'm the third one. And he was my grandfather's uncle. And he literally, I found another newspaper account that he literally dropped dead in his own barnyard, and he was not yet 50 years old. And there's also a backstory to that, because once you find a little piece of information, you start gradually filling it out. And one way or another, I found out that he had been a POW in Point Lookout in Maryland. He was a Confederate because he was North Carolinian. And he was in the same prison twice, and 4,000 people died there in about 3 years, because the Union had no interest in keeping them alive. But you don't hear about that one because the Union won the war. But that definitely affected his overall health in the long term. So you just start stringing these little pieces together to form an actual narrative. Now, another thing you should investigate is the Digital Public Library of America. I mean, and actually in this state, the state library undertook to be the hub and libraries all around the state can send things to them, and they'll work a way to post it. And this particular record was of a civil rights worker who was killed in the Freedom Rides. And you may recall them when you were kids. We were all kids about the 1960, 61. And so they actually have a lot of things. Now, you should also check out the genealogical burial sites. These are places where you can actually post a memorial. And originally, I think Find a Grave started out originally as famous people. If you want to know where Alexander Hamilton was buried, they would post things, and then they decide to open it up. And these are the two main ones, interment.net and Find a Grave. Now, they are far from complete, because you're really relying on some sort of relative to actually create a memorial and post relevant information about the deceased. But what is really important is, now this is my great grandmother, Elizabeth Smith Wilcox, and it shows you all this information. It says her birth year was 1826, which the census seems to bear out. She died in 1916, so she was 90. I mean, I actually have three people in my family who lived to 90 and more. The all-time winner was my great aunt Edna. She died at 103. And it most important is that it shows you all sorts of stuff, as she died in Surrey County, which her death certificate bears out. And her burial, though, was in a Methodist cemetery in a whole different county. I mean, she died in Surrey County, but she actually was buried in Allegheny County. So that's a whole different branch. And also, this is what I was saying before, she was a Methodist, whereas her grandson, my father, and his siblings were all Southern Baptists. So these things change all the time. Now, once you're logged in, and it's free to do this, you can actually seek out. Now, this was a memorial someone else created, but on the next slide, I added to it. And these are I added her marriage certificate from the 1850s to my great-grandfather, John B., and I put up her death certificate. And so anyone who's logged in and sets up an account can do this. I had a relative who, because you can communicate with each other, she actually emailed me saying if I wanted to take over Aunt Edna's memorial. And I told her, I said, you've done such a great job. I'm not even going to presume to take it over. But, you know, I'd like to add to it if I find anything interesting. But one warning, though, I have to give about these is that sometimes the information people post can be very, very wrong. And this actually had to do with my father's mother, Rosa Ellen. There was a woman with a similar name who died in North Carolina, and but the death certificate somebody posted that they thought was hers was for a woman who died in 1937. And I emailed them saying, this is totally wrong. I said I was born in 1950, and I knew my grandmother. So she didn't die until 1957. So always take it with a grain of salt. When I was still working here years ago, we had this patron. She would come in, and she lived in New Jersey, but she was snowbirding here. And I would walk by the genealogy section while she's on the computer, and she would shake her head at what other people put, and she'd go like, wrong, wrong. And, you know, so you really do just be a little careful with these things. Another thing is social media. If you go looking around on places, this is from Facebook, and this is one of the pages I belong to. It's the Brooklyn History genealogy, lost and found, and they can be very helpful. They often post articles about which records are available, which websites you should look for, and even better, if you join the page and they let you in, you know, they're all run by administrators, and many times they ask you generally about two or three questions like, why do you want to be on the site? Because they don't want trolls. They don't want people messing around on the site and doing really weird stuff that has nothing to do with genealogy. So they just want you to know. And of course, my interest is that I had ancestors in Brooklyn. Our relationship, the family relationship with Brooklyn goes back to the 19th century. So yeah, I definitely have an interest. One of the great things about it is that sometimes if you put out an appeal, let's say you had a relative up there that you wanted a picture of their grave. And sometimes if you ask nicely and say, if anyone's going to that cemetery and you tell them the location of the grave, they'll actually go and take a picture and they'll send it to you. So, you know, sometimes some people are really nice on these sites. Now, you should also check out historical societies because, you know, in one way or another, they have something like, for instance, Brooklyn, which was once a separate city, actually had these annual books that are in the collection here. This is the Brooklyn Historical Society, beautiful library. And these are all prominent Brooklynites, and they give you these little bios and pictures and everything of them. They did this for years and years. They often, if they were deceased, they say they tell you when they died and what their business was and all this sorts of stuff. So you really can find out a lot of good things. So never discount them. Always contact them and see what they have. And most of them do have online catalogs now. One thing you probably never thought to look at was city directories, and many of them are being digitized. And in this one, there's a whole bunch of Wilcoxes, but one of them is Rosa, and it says in 1925 she was the widow of TQ. So if I knew nothing else, I knew in 1925 TQ was gone. So you can find out a lot of different things just doing that. And also we have a great database, FOL3. Now their forte is really military records. And this is a record of a death of army personnel in one of the far western forts. And it was really, really sometimes that official report is the only record of someone's death. So definitely they have a lot of non-military records too. So if you go upstairs and say, I want to look at the FOL3 database, they'll help you out. You know, sometimes different states post things. This is Florida deaths between 1850 and 1880. And they got this from the U.S. Census, but since they only concentrate on Florida residents, sometimes these things are easier to go through. One of the things you should also remember in a census that some states like Florida had midterm censuses. So if somebody was alive in 1880, check the Florida census for 1885 to see if they were still around. And let's say you found someone in the 1910 census, check the 1935 and 1945 censuses to see if they are still around. Not every state did this, but some of them did. Also, you should look at service pensions. I actually have two service pensions that stated when their husband died, because when you have a husband who is collecting a pension, and in this case, my great-grand-aunt married a man named Shadrick Sapp, and he had a pension, but he died. Now, he died 2 years before Florida required a death certificate. And so this is the only record of his death, because she's stating she gives his original number, his pension number from that on file with the state of Florida. And she said they were married in Alachua County in March of 1862, which actually she was 4 years off, but it was close enough. And that she had not divorced him. She was legally married to him on the date of his death. And she said that was April 16, 1915. So there you go. You should also look at funeral homes. They have these extensive files of every arrangement they make. And it's such the kind of market that if one goes out of business, they often buy their records because, you know, if people tend to go to the same home, if they were satisfied when their aunt died, that when their father dies, they tend to go back. And if they're not around, they'll go to the next one. They say, oh, well, we have the records. Yeah, we can handle it. And they provide a lot of information. This is a typical one. This is from my hometown, Brooklyn, New York. This is my great aunt, Monica Gatto. She died July 22nd, 1950. So I wasn't around yet. It was very tragic too, because back in those days, Brooklyn housewives, as she lived on the second floor, would sit down on the windowsill and pull the window down over their thighs to wash the outside. And the whole thing came out of the frame as she fell down to the sidewalk. And my grandmother told me when she was in Kings County Hospital, she was in a coma. And they said, my grandmother said that the doctors told her that she doesn't come out of it in a week. There's just no hope. And she never came out. Yeah. But these cards, they were given to the mourners, and they have a prayer, but they also say which church it happened in, the funeral, when it happened. It gives you the name, John J. Dara and Sons, the funeral parlor. And in that case, you'll find in a minute about funeral homes and cemeteries. You can actually, we have upstairs cemetery directories. So if you're not sure which cemetery to contact for information, you should definitely check those books out. And the graveyard shift is just for New York City cemeteries. And there are a lot of cemeteries in New York because it's such a big city. And they give you all sorts of information. This is the cemetery at the Holy Cross, where we have some family burials. And at this point, I want to read you a letter, and I'll pass it around. My grandmother, her father died in 1954, and she wanted to know if there was any room in the future for future interments. So they misspelled her name. They said Mrs. Agnes Holden. They gave the address, and they said, number 77 Rains, 36 St. Joseph section, Agnes Marr. So I already know the location of the grave anytime I want to go there from this letter. But this letter is wonderfully macabre. It was perfect for Halloween month. And it says here that the answer to your question is no. All that can be said with reasonable reliability is that ordinarily, after the elapse of 20 years or more, there's usually enough disintegration and consolidation of old remains to allow for one more normal interment beyond the three original interments for which the grave was designed. And they said three interments have been made in the Marr grave. They have Eliza F. Casey, 51 years old. She died, the interment was 8/12/1918. She died of the Spanish flu, so that's why they bought the plot. That was my grandmother's aunt. Then there's her mother, Agnes, who was 52, and she died in 1920. And then there was Daniel, her father, who died in 1954. And it says here, based on conditions found at the time of the last burial, May 24th, 1954, the burials of 1918 and 1920 are consolidated. and occupy the lowest level. Remains of Daniel Marr occupy the second or middle level. At the third level, there is now room for one more normal interment using a box of wood of modern type up to 28 inch width. Very truly yours, Holy Cross Cemetery. And so the last interment, and up here is the St. Joseph's section right in the upper left corner. My grandmother was interred there in 1968. So based on the information in this letter, I could probably be put there if I wanted to. I mean, I actually have the deed. My grandmother had it. It's in family papers. So always look through family papers. You'll find a lot of information. But I thought you'd enjoy that letter. Now, there's often a lot of online indexes, and there's more coming all the time. This is actually from the state of New York. These are people who died in New York State in 1891. One of the things you should look, if you have anyone who may have died in New York State, always make sure it's whether they died in New York State or New York City, because New York City keeps its records separate from the rest of the state. Buffalo, Utica, you know, all of those places, that's all handled by the state of New York. But anything in the five boroughs of New York City, that's New York City stuff. Now, one thing, if you ever stumble across a death certificate that says there was an autopsy, you can always write to a medical examiner's office in that jurisdiction. And of course, they'll tell you which county the death occurred and where the autopsy occurred. You just have to write to them. Now, it's the same thing as most death certificates. You generally have to have some sort of legal interest in seeing the report. Although in some states, it seems like sometimes they can be public information. You may perhaps have heard that in certain mass shootings or something, the autopsy records were actually made public, and there was this big furor over there. People were very, very upset. So always write to them. They'll tell you exactly what you can and can't do. Now, of course, finally, we're getting to the wills. And I say will and estate inventories because sometimes people don't die with a will. What you find are inventories of their estate. They're listing their personal possessions. And there's all sorts of things involving wills, depending on the law at the time. A good example of that, remember Daniel Howe, my Revolutionary War ancestor? Well, his father lived a long time too. He died in 1799 in Virginia, in Montgomery County. And he named all of his children, what he was going to leave them, particular possessions, things like a spinning wheel, an anvil, a horse. You know, these were typical things at the time. The one person not named was his oldest son, Daniel. And there is a reason why, because at the time, Virginia had a law they called a primogeniture, which meant the oldest son inherited the bulk of the estate. And that's why he wasn't in the will, because he was the oldest son. And so he had already gotten his settlement. He inherited his father's main farm and whatever was on it. And there were a lot of ways of getting around it. If you ever go to Williamsburg, Colonial Williamsburg, there's an estate nearby called Carter's Grove. And one of the ways they did it, the person who built it, his name was Robert Carter. He actually willed that estate, that plantation, to his second grandson, because he knew under the law his first grandson would inherit his father's estate and his second grandson would get nothing. So he willed the property to his second grandson, but he willed a portion of the profits to his daughter, who was this boy's mother. So they had to be creative. And one of the ways Virginia ended this law was Thomas Jefferson. If you ever go to his estate, Monticello, you'll see his gravestone. And one of the things he wanted to be remembered for was ending the law of primogeniture in the state of Virginia. The thing that's not on the stone is that he composed the Declaration of Independence. So go figure that. But you also learn a lot about family dynamics from wills. I once saw a seminar when I was still working here online, and it was about Pennsylvania records. And they quoted a will that perhaps is the most lurid one in American jurisprudence, because the deceased, this was the early 19th century, left his son-in-law a coil of rope with which to hang himself. And he, yes, this is really true. He actually wrote this, and he instructed his daughter to divorce him in order to get her inheritance. I mean, you know, so you learn a lot. Now, one of the best ways to look for a will is, because very seldom do you find a lot of will indexes on county websites, but there's a lot of books, and we have a whole bunch of them upstairs. These are what they call will summaries. So they give you the most important building. They tell you where it's probated, which county, when it was probated. They give you a little summary of the heirs and basically what it was about. So you can actually write to the jurisdiction and say, I want this will for this person probated on the state, and they can generally find it. I have Daniel's father's will. He died in 1774, and I got it from the proto notary's office in Philadelphia. So sometimes you have to sort of wade through and try and figure out who actually has this stuff. I mean, there's all these different ways to do it, because like in a lot of states, anything to do with probating a will is gonna be something like chancery court. In Florida, it's handled by the county circuit court. So you always gotta, you know, keep that investigation. And we better get out of here soon, because we're dying. But there are some online indexes. And this is one for Texas, so you could always just sort of Google around and see if you could find. And sometimes there are abstracts are digitized. North Carolina has done that, and they have a lot of things. They actually have a database called MARS for manuscripts and research services. It's an excellent catalog. And, you know, I would suggest, when you request a copy, sending a stamp self-addressed envelope and a check for copying fees, generally a nominal amount, like $10. And I mean, they have to provide the information, but every request you make is coming out of their budget. And this sort of helps, it sort of greases the system, as it were. And that's what I would do. I always did that. And sometimes some people do post them online. Sometimes family websites post them online. Sometimes historical societies post them online. So that's a pretty good shortcut. And this is the last slide. I thought this was a perfect Halloween picture. And there's a special thing. This is probably the oldest existing cemetery in New York City. It's in my hometown of Brooklyn. And it's the Gravesend Cemetery, which was once its own village. Now it's a neighborhood. And it was established in 1658. And the founder was very interesting. It's the only one of the six original towns, European towns in Brooklyn, that was founded by a woman, the Lady Deborah Moody. And they believe she and her son are actually buried in this cemetery. They're not sure, because those stones you see are basically 18th and 19th century. All the older ones are illegible or just worn down to the ground. But, you know, the probabilities are that she is there, because she did die in 1659. So I thought that was like the perfect way to end this beautiful picture. But I want to thank you all for coming. It was a lot of fun. And if you have any questions, I see some familiar faces there. Hello. And yeah, so thanks a lot.